So far, we have talked about the different sources of nonlinearity and why is it important to account for them in our engineering analysis. Now let's investigate some examples and see practically how much of a difference do they make. In this lesson, we have lined up four different examples, each of which presents how different sources of nonlinearity are introduced into a system. In the first example, we start with a simple dog bone sample that is made up of polyethylene material. It's a very common practice to use such samples to perform tensile testing, which in turn is used for calculating material properties. We use this to see how the tensile response starts linear at small deformations and turns nonlinear as the deformation increases. In the second example, we use the same dog bone but replace the material with that of a rubber and see how material nonlinearity plays a role in making the model nonlinear. In the third example, we move on to a closed vessel that has a graphite gasket sandwiched between two steel plates. In this example, we'll see how contact nonlinearity is responsible for making a model nonlinear. And in the fourth and final example, we'll look at a snap fit buckle, which has all the three nonlinearities and an additional case of loss of contact. Let's start by looking at the behavior of polyethylene material, which is widely used in various applications due to its low weight to strength ratio. There are various grades of this material, such as high or low density polyethylene, that are used in many commercial products, such as bottles and caps, phone and tablet cover cases, and fasteners in several assemblies. To be able to use them as part of the design, the first thing to do is to calculate the material properties of the grade of polyethylene that we are working with. We start with tensile testing of polyethylene sample, which is typically made into a dog bone structure. The sample is held rigidly on one end and it is pulled at a constant rate on the other while a load cell records the force reaction. In order to compare the effect of large deformation versus small deformation, we'll simulate two different cases. The first one, the sample is stretched to a displacement of 0.1 mm. The second one, the sample is stretched to a displacement of 10 mm. During deformation, the area of cross-section of the sample decreases due to Poisson's effect, and this introduces nonlinearity. Let's start by plotting the force displacement curve for first case. As we can see, the response is linear and can be assumed to be a linear system. But when we continue to stretch it to a displacement of 10 mm, which is case 2, we start seeing that the force displacement response deviates from the linear curve. This can be explained from monitoring the area of cross-section at midplane during the deformation. In case 1, the change in area of cross-section is very small, but as we increase the amount of deformation, the area reduces nonlinearly and starts affecting the system's response. So, from this example, we can see why we need to use a nonlinear solver to analyze a structure when it is known to undergo large deformation. In this case, if we idealize this system to be linear, then we'll be overpredicting the force reaction by a huge difference, and this will result in faulty designs. Now, moving on to the next example, where we will investigate the material nonlinearity. To do this, let's take the same dog bone geometry, but test the response for two different materials, an elastomer and an aluminum alloy. Elastomers are very soft materials and are commonly used in making gaskets, O-rings, and in some cases as mounts for mitigating the vibration from heavy machines. Due to their soft nature, They tend to deform severely, which naturally makes them susceptible to large deformation. However, due to their nonlinear material behavior, they tend to have a nonlinear force response even at small deformations. To demonstrate this, we perform a displacement control test on two dog bone samples, one made of elastomer and the other made of aluminum. Since we are operating under small deformation, the aluminum sample records a linear force displacement response. But at the same small deformation, the elastomer sample records a nonlinear response. Even though there isn't a huge change in the area of cross-section, the elastomer sample deforms nonlinearly due to its material behavior. So, a nonlinear solver is required to analyze a system made of such materials. For our next example, let's look at a pressured vessel. A key design feature for such vessels is to retain the pressure inside the vessel, and one way to do that is to prevent any leakage of its contents. Gaskets are commonly used for this purpose. They are sandwiched between the vessel and its closing cap. By doing so, the gasket material deforms and creates a contact pressure. This pressure must be more than the pressure of the contents of the vessel to make sure that they don't escape out. In this example, we take one such vessel with a geometry simplified for our demonstration purpose. In this case, we have a gasket sandwiched and the pressure is developed by tightening a set of four bolts. Let's use a graphite gasket for this case, as it may be approximated to be linear at small deformations. So we've eliminated, or rather mitigated, the effects of the other two nonlinearities, so we can focus on the third nonlinearity, which is contact. Since the graphite is arrested between the two plates and it doesn't separate from either surface, we may, in theory, solve this case using a linear solver. To do this, we approximate the contact to be bonded. By doing so, we prevent the gasket material to slide over the surfaces when it deforms. Now let's get realistic and replace the bonded contact with a frictional contact, so the graphite can slide when it deforms. This is closer to reality. Now, let's compare the force displacement response for these two cases. In case of bonded contact, we do get a linear response. But when we replace it with a more realistic contact type, the response is clearly nonlinear. Surely, the second analysis is more realistic. But is this difference big enough to affect our engineering judgment? There's only one way to find out. Let's compare the contact pressure, which is the quantity of interest for this analysis, calculated from both the contact treatments. As we can see, there's a 52% difference in the calculated contact pressures. So, by assuming that the contact to be bonded, we are overestimating the operational pressure limits of the vessel. This leads us to a design failure, which could be catastrophic. Now, coming to our fourth and final example, we'll look at a snap fit buckle, which are commonly used in backpacks. In this case, there's usually presence of all the nonlinearities to some degree. But at the moment of engagement, there's a sudden loss of contact, which adds a fourth type of nonlinearity, which is a loss in stiffness. Usually when this happens, it makes the model unstable, a concept that we'll discuss in a future course. A loss of stiffness is a direct indication of a physical phenomena, and ignoring it would disregard the said physics. Due to this reason, we cannot solve such systems using linear solvers. Let's go ahead and study the system using a nonlinear solver and look at the force displacement response. As you can see, the response is nonlinear. But focus on this portion of the curve where it shows there's a sudden drop in reaction force. This is the stage where the snap fit gets to an engaged position and starts providing the support that it was intended to. For an engineer who's trying to design one such systems, may be interested in knowing at what sliding distance does it engage and how much force resistance does the system offer during this process. Such an analysis can help them in tweaking the geometric features and even the material selection for the assembly, so it meets their design requirements. So we've seen different practical examples and how different sources of nonlinearity play a part in modifying the response of the system. There are many more such examples that can demonstrate these nonlinearities, and we will explore them as we encounter them during discussions on other topics.